Hi guys, welcome to Wade's Wilderness. Today I'm going to try and rehouse this little guy. My camera will focus on him. So this is a Devil's Flower Mantis, or Idolomantis Diabloica. Really awesome specimen. And as we saw in the previous video, I needed to get on that really quickly and make him a new enclosure, because the one I had was way too small for his needs. And these guys can be quite difficult to look after, as they do require specific humidity and temperature. They like flying prey, and there's tons of fungus gnats plaguing this room at the moment, but I think they're way too small for him. Probably saw one just fly past, thought he might grab it, but not quite brave enough. But yeah, I've got big plans for the enclosure I want to keep him in. But most importantly, check out those dance moves.
Show me your moves!
So this is almost finished. It should be a good dry enclosure for the Devil's Flower Mantis. I've made the background out of plaster of Paris and then painted it to give it kind of a rocky effect. I'm not going to take credit for how I've done it. There's a video that I found on sort of terrain tutorials that people use for games workshops and railway models and things like that, that gives a good rock effect. And it's basically just using tin foil that's scrunched up a bit and then pouring plaster cast in it to give that kind of effect, and then painting it afterwards. I'm not the best at painting, but it'll be all right. I'll put some greenery around it, spice it up a bit. But I just wanted something that's a bit different to my other enclosures and a bit more dry and arid looking, because it will suit the Devil's Flower Mantis a bit better. What with him liking sort of the high heat and low humidity, nothing's going to grow in there anyway. So it's almost done. I just need to put a little latch on the front. I've also kind of modified the sides of it and made a little frame with some wire mesh on, because the Devil's Flower Mantis is an empicid, I think it's called. They don't grip very well onto the glass or plastic, so it's kind of advantageous to have something on the sides for him to grip on. So I think he'll grip on the back okay, and he's also got the sides to grab onto. These are custom made enclosures that I've done. I've got a few actually. I've got a few that are lying around, so I've made four of these now. And the way that I do it is I actually buy, because I found it was cheaper, you can get these like glass clip frames, which are these kind of things, like that you just have a bit of MDF on the back and you just kind of clip the bit of glass on the front and put whatever image or picture you want in the middle. I bought a load of them because it works out way cheaper than trying to buy custom made glass. The edges come polished as well, so you don't have to worry about polishing all the edges of the glass, and they're not as sharp. And it works out about £1 a time for one of these. So you can make one of these enclosures for about £6. The glass cutting I was a bit intimidated by, but it's actually a lot easier than you think, and it's way easier than trying to work with perspex. I did though have to make a perspex frame at the bottom and drill those holes in, because I'm not going to attempt to drill glass. You can just get cheap hinges and little magnetized door catches for the rest of it. It just works out a lot cheaper, because when you look around at these enclosures, you know, they, for a start, they're not, it's hard to find ones that kind of suit a mantis, because you obviously want more height than you do length. I don't like the plasticky looking ones. I don't like the ones that have like plastic framing. I like to have them kind of where you can see in from all sides and angles. There's nothing blocking your sight on them. So I just thought it's better for me to make my own ones, and with a bit of practice, they're starting to come out really nice now. So the only thing with this background though is, and if anyone's got any tips, let me know, but it's a nightmare to try and get things to stick to it because it's plaster. Nothing seems to adhere to it very well, so I tried all kinds of glue, didn't work, because I just wanted to glue it to the back of this bit of wood, just did not work. So what I had to do in the end, and you can't really see it, but I had to kind of glue a bit of, you can see the edge of it there a little bit, it's just a bit of this screen stuff, and I managed to glue that to the plaster cast. Then I had to glue that to this bit of foam stuff, just because it just evened out the contours a little bit. And then glue that onto the bit of MDF and then silicone that to the back. And that seems to be holding pretty well there. But I don't really know the best way of adhering plaster to a bit of wood, to be honest. So any ideas, let me know. I don't think I'll have to make many of these though, because it's just kind of very specific for that species. I know it's probably it is a bit overkill, because most people will just keep them in a mesh cage or netted kind of enclosure, which is good and fine, but I just like my enclosures to look nice. I don't really like the look of those, just a netted square. It's just a bit boring. I just noticed something. This is really funny. My giant Asian mantis is always on the lookout into this enclosure for my curly-haired tarantula. Keeps an eye on her. If she's out wandering around, she'll come and peek at her. She really wants her for dinner. I think you'd win in a fight, but I'm not going to test that theory. I might have to get a divider, because it might be a bit stressful seeing her staring in at you with hungry eyes. Clay balls. Wire mesh to stop the substrate dropping through. Sphagnum moss to help with the drainage. Substrate. So even though I'm going to be keeping this really dry, I probably don't need this substrate in, because, well, it's just going to hold moisture, which I don't particularly want, but I am just in the habit of building the enclosures this way, so I'll still put it in just as a bit of a base layer. And it will give something to for the rocks to sit on. Now, where to position my rock? Well, these little sparkly rocks, I don't know what they'll look like. It might make it look really tacky though. Yeah, they're a bit too white. Too white and sparkly. That looks better. Stood up. Okay, I'm pretty happy with how that's looking so far. Now I'm going to try and add some sand in here, and I hope it doesn't completely ruin the aesthetic, but let's give it a go. And some really white sand. Check everything's secure. I feel like he doesn't have enough hanging spots, but then, to be fair, he is going to have the sides to hang from if he needs to. Maybe I will add one more spot for him to hang from, just in case. Okay, that's a bit better. Well, at least for the sand, I won't get any fungus gnats in this one. I do just want to add some moss in the back. Those lines look a bit harsh coming into the cliffs. If I add some moss, it will probably turn brown anyway over time. You know what, instead of the moss, let's maybe put one of these in. That's much better. I have a feeling that I'm going to end up swapping out my Devil's Flower Mantis, well, if I get a Desert Mantis, and putting him in here, because it is actually looking very desert-like at the moment. But that's cool. The main thing is he just has somewhere more spacious for him to roam around in, practice his dancing. So there we go. This should be absolutely fine for him. I'm pretty pleased with this. I think the only thing is the gravel the sand is a little bit too white because it's aquarium gravel, but it's fine. It might age a bit over time and dirty up because the background looks a little bit off compared to the rest of it, but that's cool. The main thing is he's got plenty of hanging spots now. He should be a lot happier in here. So what I'll do next is just pop the top on and leave that overnight just to air out a little bit, and then we'll move him in. Here's the finished product. I had a bit of a change of heart. I wanted to get that stone the same kind of colour as the background, so I did kind of give it a bit of a wash and just added a few more bits just to add to the aesthetic. But let's get him in. Here he is. He can't wait to get in his new home. Gonna be so well camouflaged. So I'm aware normally that these guys would be chilling out on flowers and stuff, so I'm thinking about getting some kind of white flower to go in here with him, just so he's got a bit of foliage. There you go. Hopefully you will like this as your new home. Come on, look at him. No, he didn't want to go. Trust me, you'll much prefer it in there. You've got so much more space. That's it. And I've got these adapted, so they've got sliding lids. I need to add the gliders on top of this to finish it off, but I just want to get him in there for now. So he's got loads of space to move around in. So due to the heat conditions that this guy needs, what I would do is have a heat mat on the back of this tank. Not underneath, but at the back, just so he's got a gradient that he can, or she can, position herself where she's most comfortable. And going forwards, I've got some blue bottle flies at the ready. These guys eat a lot, so every couple of days I'll chuck a blue bottle fly in there, see if I can witness him getting a mid-air catch. That'd be awesome. We'll check in on him, make sure he's all settled in a few hours, and hopefully he'll be a happy little mantis, albeit a very formidable looking dude once he's fully grown. And there's the dude. Settled in. Seems like he's loving life in there. Hopefully he'll be very prosperous in his new enclosure. Aren't you, mate? And typically, he's not chilling on any of the stuff that I've made for him. He's just being boring and sitting on the side.